Thank you very much, Chair, and greetings to all of the colleagues online as well as those who are physically present in the room in London. There's a lot which has been said, which of course resonates with me from the various presentations we've had so far. And in thinking about how to maximize the 10-15 minutes available to me, I thought, you know, thinking back to the life, the times, the works of Thandika, about the things which especially struck me in my own years of association with him as a mentee, as a colleague, as a co-author, somebody who also succeeded him at Kodesria, an institution which was very dear to him to the very end of his life. And I would say that perhaps three things serve as an important entry point, things which resonated with me, and I guess with many of my generation, whom would probably consider in terms of the three generations thesis that he proposed as the second generation. Three things. The first of them was a certain insurgent spirit, which may not have come across as evident for many, except perhaps at the point of reading him or listening to him, but which was always there in terms of being basically one who challenged received wisdom on an ongoing basis. And that insurgent spirit, in order for it to be meaningful and make the kind of impact which he was able to make, he always insisted to us, had to be rigorous. Rigor, the centrality of rigor. I would recall, for example, that in the context of some of the discussions in the 80s and 90s about multidisciplinarity and transdisciplinarity and the like, and for somebody who was himself a consummate multidisciplinarist, he would very quickly remind us of the importance of knowing the disciplines first before venturing into multidisciplinary exercises. You could not really make the kind of bold claims and statements that you would want to make if you did not understand the basics of your primary discipline before projecting out. And this could be extended to the entire field of knowledge creation and endeavor in which he engaged. And at the third level, was in a sense connected also to insurgency of the spirit and of scholarship, was his conviction that there was really nothing particularly exceptional about the African experience. And that from that point of view, I would say, Joachim, that although his European and other experiences may have served him well, especially his time as a student, and a lecturer in Sweden with the Stockholm School of Economics, they have played an important part in his in the shaping of his overall approach and world outlook. It was also important from the point of view of rigor and disruption that he embraced for a comparative dimension to be almost natural to the work which he did, especially from the point of view of an African scholar who had been essentially, and that continues to this day, been brought up to understand the African world on the basis of stylized narratives about what has happened elsewhere to bring about transformation, and which therefore created a sense of a unilinear approach to development. That was completely unhelpful, neither for the creativity of spirit, which the context and environment in Africa provided and demanded at the same time, nor for the possibility of bringing originality to thinking about specific African challenges and how we might respond to them. And in this regard, I think his critique of stylized knowledge, which extended to suggestions about African studies broadly defined and basically North American at the time. African studies basically comprised a collection of what one might call science by analogy. This is how it happened in the history of the US, supposedly, and this is how it happened in the history of Europe, supposedly. This is why it is not happening in the same way in Africa, and that constitutes the originality of thesis that is presented to us. I recall in this regard that in the context of discussions and debates we had around the African state, a state which had come under focus in the 1980s for various reasons, but not least on account of the record of authoritarianism that had gripped the continent in the course of the period from the second half of the 60s to the end of the 1980s, but also the onset of structural adjustment and its critique of the African state. Thandika basically stood out amongst his colleagues within the African social science community in the sense that for many of them, like him, they had been brought up as a first generation in the context of a Marxist political economy revolution in the African social sciences. And for those of us who came as a second generation or a third generation, who haven't been trained by some of the first generation, embraced much of the critique of the African state in that Marxist political economy tradition of ideas about the neo-colonial state, ideas about the dependent African state, ideas about the underdeveloped state, or for those who chose to follow the likes of Hamza Alavi to talk about the overdeveloped state in terms of the bureaucratic authoritarianism, which Hamza Alavi was describing in the case of Pakistan when he published his work. That all of these seemed to us to be logical explanations of the problems of development confronting the African continent. But what was interesting about Thandika was that, unlike many of his peers, he was not one given to what I would call today a sloganeering about the nature of the African state. And although he would agree that there were vestiges, important vestiges of neocolonialism, of underdevelopment and of dependence, he did not see these as fatalistic conditions. At best, at worst, transitory situations, but at best also, he drew attention to important changes and important visions of leadership that were at play in the first generation of post-colonial African leadership that could not simply be waved off with labels around neo-colonialism, about dependency and underdevelopment. The examples, for example, to cite the cases of Julius Nyerere, or even Kwame Nkrumah, or even Sekou Touré of Guinea, and what fired them in terms of their own approach to building a post-colonial state, meant that there were no easy labels that could be attached to the nature of the state. And he carried this argument further when he began to deconstruct the direction of policy in the first two decades of independence, in which, if we follow it closely, he was to argue in our continent, our future, that regardless of the ideological disposition of many of the first generation of Africa's post-colonial leaders, and in spite of the relationship that they may have had with any metropolitan center, most of them actually pursued the same broad spectrum of policies that involved elements of state interventionism, which in fact was also the rigor in the international system whether across the developed world or in the global south. And from that point of view, African countries were not themselves different in any fundamental way in terms of the kinds of states and the kinds of state interventions broadly defined that they pursued. The deliberate demonization of the states that followed the structural adjustment years that entered into the discussion during the structural adjustment years, therefore stood almost in direct opposition to this interpretation of the first two decades independence politics and policy making on the continent. Again, we see here, I think, a very careful nuancing of analysis, in which, of course, he did not necessarily say that all was El Dorado with regard to policy making and state form in the post-colonial period, but at the same time rejected some of the reductionism, either of the neo-Marxist critiques of post-colonial state policies, or indeed the demonization of the state in what was to him a tendentious reading, deliberately tendentious reading of the nature and policy directions of the post-colonial state that the IMF and the World Bank promoted in the 1980s, in the 1990s, following the Berg Report and the introduction of structural adjustment. In a piece which we contributed to a conference that was held in Uppsala in Sweden, and a division of labor which we undertook, we carried out a deliberate exercise of simply looking at the literature on the African states published outside the African continent, influential and powerful as they were, and came up with not less than 22 adjectives that had been used by different authors in different institutional settings to capture the African state. Some of them are very familiar with us. To us, the neo-patrimonial state, for example, the neo-patrimonial school, but there were also references to the sultanist state, to the crony state, to the unsteady state, and so on and so forth. Altogether, 22 of them, which we captured, but which at the end of the day, again, with reference to the witticism that was an important and an essential part of Thandika's critique of received wisdom, which essentially stood in contradiction to some of the objectives that had been defined for the structural adjustment state in Africa. A state which, it was argued, on account of all of those adjectives, had to be fundamentally reformed by being reduced to a night watchman state, playing a minimalist role in order to give free rein to the market in the allocation of values and resources, but which simultaneously was expected to do all kinds of things in the name of structural adjustment, to offer incentives to the market, to manage the labor market, to attract foreign investment, to exercise good governance policies, a whole gamut of policies that the IMF and the World Bank put on the table of the African states simultaneously with their demonization of the state and an insistence that it had to be both cut down to size and minimized in terms of its role. And in contesting this, it was not so much a contestation that was anchored, even if he was very aware of avenues for such contestation in terms of the class project which structural adjustment represented, but basically in pointing to the contradictoriness of the agenda of the IMF and the World Bank, even on the terrain on which they were situated, and therefore making the case that even if structural adjustment was a valid framework for the reform of African economies in crisis, it could not happen without an effective state. And within this context, it was to his credit that preparatory to the 1989 Accelerated Development in Africa report of the World Bank, Thandika was to be joined by a group of African, other African scholars, the late Claude Ake, the late NS Wamba Diawamba, Professor George Nzogola Ntalaja, Peter Anyang Yongo, and a whole host of others who came together, assembled under CODESRIA, to make the case that the key challenge confronting African development was not so much one of getting prices right, as had been argued by Berg, but of actually getting politics right. Governance, not markets, as such, constituted the big challenge which Africa needed to overcome in order to be able effectively to tackle the challenges of its development. And to the extent to which politics, getting politics right, was the key concern that had to be tackled, it effectively opened up the community to debates about the nature of the state, about the nature of politics, the imperative of transcending authoritarianism and building more democratic political systems that shaded into the developments that we witnessed across the continent in the 1990s and opened up discussions about the democratic developmental state. And the question for Africa, I'm closing, is not so much about an absence of capacity, as the bank and the fund and others were to argue subsequently. In fact, Thandika was to deride that claim about a lack of capacity in the African state or the African political economy by suggesting that what the Bretton Woods institutions missed was not so much that there was no capacity within the continent, but that the capacity that was available was simply not prepared to accept the neoliberal orthodoxies that they sought to impose on the countries of the continent. And from that point of view, therefore, the argument for a democratic developmental state as a logical response to the crisis confronting African countries seems to make all of the sense. And I would argue that in order to carry the work he did around the democratic developmental states forward, it seems to me, and that is part of my own preoccupation at this point in time, that we have come to a point where the state as an instrument in the service of a neoliberal orthodoxy that assumes that everything else has to be done in order to have properly functioning markets. Everything else has to be subordinated to the logic of the market. We've come to a point where we should, in fact, be reversing the question and asking what kinds of economies, what kinds of politics do we need in order to build properly functioning democratic developmental states on our continent. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Where's your, why don't you join me up here, Joachim, in case there's. Okay, I think we have a few minutes as we adjust the time of the break, so we can take a few concise comments or questions to any of the speakers. So, yeah.
Thank you for both speakers. My name is Iyob, former colleague here at ID, currently at University of Bristol. My question is for Bio. I wonder if you can comment on the last bit of your presentation where you talk about the democratic developmental state. I wonder to what extent even Thandika has purely conceptualized and kind of investigated the democratic aspect of that of the African state. Because what we are seeing at the moment is the introduction of this extremely liberal political space where two political parties, which with very limited base, very narrow base, competing for election every 4 or 5 years without having any room to have institutional capacity to implement or envisage transformative development. I wonder to what extent we can kind of conceptualize and see it in for the foreseeable future to be something that can be realized. Because what I'm seeing at the moment that's celebrated as democratic African countries like Kenya or Ghana, where you really don't see that transformative element in the policy space. Thank you.
Thanks, Theo. Maybe I should take, are there any other comments or questions first? Okay, so would you like to answer that?
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much, Eo. I'm sure that there's some work which he did around this. I'm sure that for Thandika, it would be a very hard sell to say that what we have as political practice across Africa today would qualify entirely as being defined as democratic. He, of course, very much welcomed and even lodged a cordial program around the political transitions of the 1990s across the continent and the prospects which they offered for complementing efforts at transformation with much more broad-based popular participation in governance. In most of the countries. And that embrace of the transitions as they unfolded was itself based, founded on his reading of the failings of authoritarianism on the continent. Because remember that Africa entered independence on the basis of one form or the other of political pluralism before that became mutated into single party regimes and the onset of military rule. And his critique of authoritarianism was that unlike in parts of the global south, like the East Asian countries, for example, where there was a certain quid pro quo available to the population in terms of the development outcomes associated with authoritarian governance in those parts of the world. In the African context, we did not get that kind of outcome. And I recall in one of the debates we had where suggestions were made that perhaps the problem with Africa's development was an inability to replicate what the East Asian tigers had done. His argument was simply that Africa haven't experienced the kinds of authoritarianism. Himself, Thandika, having been a victim of those kinds of authoritarianism in his own early years of political engagement. He argued that Africa is condemned to democracy. And in that notion is the idea that the democratic consciousness is part of the being of everybody. And Africans have repeatedly shown in various forms that they want democracy in the sense of being able to participate in decisions that affect their lives on an everyday basis. And to that extent, it should be possible for us as perhaps a contribution to the progression of human civilization to have state forms that are democratic and at the same time developmental. And I think his article in the Cambridge Journal of Economics on the feasibility of the democratic developmental state attempted to answer the question that claimed that it was an impossibility to have a democratic developmental project in Africa in a fairly convincing way, which I'm sure you have read here. And if you haven't, I would recommend to you. So the work of building the developmental state in Africa and simultaneously imbuing it with a democratic content is an unfinished business. It's still ongoing. It's one which I think offers the continent a way out of also ensuring that democracy delivers democratic dividends.